Nemo Radio is on the air.
A, B, C. A, always B, B, C, closing. Always be closing. Always be closing.
Shirley, you can't be serious.
I am serious. And don't call me Shirley.
Put that coffee down.
Coffee's for closers only.
Come after me! I'm a man! I'm 40!
Welcome back to another episode of Nemo Radio. It's John Nemo. So excited that you're here with me on this podcast. And I have a story totally stuck in my head. So I got to get this out because it is such a good metaphor for what's going on in the world today with business, with being successful, with really ensuring that your product or service stands out from the crowd. It's really the one thing that we cannot lose sight of, you know, as we get into all the new tools and tactics and techniques and technologies. And here's the story. So this was back when I was working a regular kind of corporate day job. And I'll never forget this. One of our coworkers, their spouse tragically died, like dropped dead, totally unexpected, very sad. And we all went to the funeral, the whole office. And I'll never forget, I was walking out of the funeral with one of our bosses, with actually the big boss of the company. And this person, this big boss, was a real grouch and ruled with an iron fist and ruled this company, this organization with fear, had a lot of power. You know, I was terrified of this person. Basically, my first meeting with the person that took over was, I don't like you. If I could, I'd fire you. You know, just very like threatening me. You better toe the line. And, you know, so controlled all of us with an iron fist and with fear and power and everything else. And so, again, I'm walking out of the funeral, this life moment with this boss. And the boss actually turns to me and says, kind of under his breath, no one's going to come to my funeral. No one's going to come to my funeral. And I thought, well, my first thought was, yeah, you're probably right. Sorry. I was like, yeah, you're probably right because you're such a jerk. But it was very telling. It was very telling because this manager, this boss, this person, the only way, for whatever reason, whatever their story was, the only way they knew how to manage was through fear, through power, through control, through threat. And yet underneath this veneer of this boss that we all thought was so tough and mean and grouchy and, you know, armor plated was this sadness of no one's going to come to my funeral. Nobody really loves me or likes me. And this leads into such a critical lesson that we have to remember when it comes to our business and how we're doing things today, whatever situation you're in. And it goes back to this classic book that I'm rereading, re-listening to again, How to Win Friends and Influence People by Dale Carnegie. And he wrote it back in 1936. And he, you know, obviously summarized these core principles that are more true now today than ever about the importance of human engineering, as he called it, the ability and the skill to handle people. In fact, Carnegie says in the book, he says, 85% of your success in any industry, doesn't matter if you're a chemical engineer, doctor, lawyer, teacher, business person, coach, consultant, whatever it is, 85% of your success is dependent on how well you handle people, your skills in quote unquote human engineering. And you think about that. You think about the people who are really successful. What are they really good at? They're really good at handling people, inspiring, motivating, you know, pushing the right buttons, getting people involved. John D. Rockefeller, one of the titans of the time, said to Carnegie, he said, the ability to deal with people is as purchasable a commodity as sugar or coffee. And I will pay more for that ability than for any under the sun. And there was another famous person at the time that's cited in the book, Charles Schwab. And, you know, he says, my smile is worth $1 million a year. Like, what? Because he had this ability to connect with people. He had this ability to, you know, have this human engineering skill. And where this ties into the funeral story and that grouchy boss of mine saying, no one's going to come to my funeral, is really around this core thing that everyone wants. And this is another quote from Carnegie's book. He says, in our interpersonal relations, we should never forget that all of our associates are human beings and hunger for appreciation. We hunger for appreciation. Carnegie says it's the legal tender that all souls enjoy. Everyone wants to feel appreciated. Everyone wants to feel validated. Everyone wants to feel heard. And everyone wants to feel important. And you cannot forget these human elements when you go out and you are running a business, whether you're doing sales, customer service. Oh, and you've heard me rant before about some of my customer service nightmares. And the core issue of all those stories is me as the customer wanting to feel appreciated, wanting to feel valued, wanting to feel important. And Carnegie tells story after story in that book about that's what people really want. And this is what I'm finding too in my own business today is all of the services that you and I offer. So it could be business coaching, LinkedIn training, you know, whatever it is, plumbing, anything. All of those services are commoditized. They're now available anywhere from anyone, anytime for just about any price, correct? Like you can find, take my LinkedIn riches and LinkedIn training. You can find a million LinkedIn trainers sharing tons of information. You can find lots of tips for free. You can find lots of different price points for LinkedIn trainers. What really sets me apart, what's going to set you apart in this area is that 85% of LinkedIn training is how do you deal with people? How do you make your clients and customers feel? Do you make them feel appreciated, important, validated? Do you inspire them? Do you motivate them? Do you listen to them and get into their story and say, I want to help you achieve your dreams? I just had a coaching client write to me, and this coaching client said, hey, you know, I really want to refocus my business to get this new project off the ground. And I'm inspired, I'm motivated watching you that I want to be able to, you know, sell an online course and do a webinar and make sales while I'm walking the dog and all these things. And instead of me just going immediately, what I could have said to this coaching client was, great, why don't you buy my course Webinars That Work? That'll show you all the webinar tips that I use. That'll show you all the tricks. And then I want you to buy this other course of mine and then pay me for more coaching, and I'll help you build the framework to do that model, right? What I did instead was I said, you know, tell me about your new baby, the new child that you just had. Because again, you want to keep tabs on what's important to your clients and customers. I knew this particular client had a new baby, had a new child. Oh, we're doing great. Here's the scoop. And you know what I did was, not in a manipulative way, but in an honest way of actually caring about this client as a human being and appreciating what's important to this client, what's going on in this client's life. I knew this person had a baby. How's that going? How's that baby doing? And they told me, and then I said, you know, what would be really exciting to really get you motivated to achieve this goal is I want you to start thinking about you're pushing that new baby in the stroller and getting alerts on your iPhone of making course sales, right? Because that's tapping into that client's passion. That's tapping into that client's personal life, personal story. That client is feeling important, appreciated, validated, motivated. Not me just thinking of myself going, well, what can I sell this client to, you know, get them, you know, to achieve this outcome. Yes, there are going to be sales conversations and products I can offer this client and services to help them achieve it. But if I don't connect emotionally with the client, if I don't make that client feel appreciated and excited and, you know, I believe in you and let's get your dream coming true, the sales aren't going to happen. The sales process is much easier when someone is feeling like you're in my corner, you appreciate me, you get it, you understand what I'm trying to do, you actually care about me, you ask about my life and my kids and my family. And, you know, I just had a coworker of mine who's had to put their dog down. And it's like, oh man, you know, me selfishly could just be like, is that going to impact the work you're supposed to be doing for me? Right? Like, oh no, are you going to get behind on your tasks? No, like I stopped and put myself in that person's shoes. And it's easy for me because I'm a dog person. And if you're listening, you're a dog person, you know how hard it is if you have to put your beloved family pet down, right? And I'm like, that's brutal. That's horrible. I still remember being a kid and my dad taking our childhood dog, Molly, to get, you know, put down. And that was the end of the show for her. And he came back and he said, I'll never have another dog. That was the hardest thing I ever had to do. And I just can't do it again. And it was so brutal and gut-wrenching. And I'm like, wow, you know. And of course, we got a new puppy a couple, probably several months later. And, you know, the cycle starts again. And that dog brought a ton of joy. But but it's powerful and it's important. And so, you know, what I was able to say to this coworker was just, hey, I totally relate. I totally understand. Here are some thoughts, you know, about your family, about your dog, about what I believe, you know, with dogs in heaven and some fun things to think about and look forward to. And it's a real loss. And I'm sorry. And I appreciate what you're going through, and just take the time that you need, you know. And it was like, it doesn't take a lot of extra effort or time or money for you and me just to be kind and to be appreciative and to ask just a couple questions, not to get into an episode of Oprah or Dr. Phil and let's spend an hour counseling each and every client of ours about their life dramas, but just to do those simple things. And that just really ties back to that funeral story of what will be your legacy, what will be your impact. Because for that boss, the way that that boss treated people, who, again, the ability to deal with people, you know, is as purchasable a commodity as sugar or coffee. I will pay more for that ability than any other ability under the sun. That's what Rockefeller said. This boss did not have that ability. This boss's way of treating people was fear, intimidation, you know, just power and scared, right? So no one was going to go out of their way to help that boss. No one was going to show up at that boss's funeral. No one was going to, you know, go the extra mile. And so if you're running a company, obviously that's not a great way to manage. Whereas people like Charles Schwab and Rockefeller and Carnegie know this. They know that this is so critical, the ability to manage people. And I think it's really interesting because of the era we live in now, where there are so many tools and products and ways to commoditize. So why do you choose the vendors that you choose? Why do you choose the coaches, consultants, partners, service providers that you decide on? It's relational. It's emotional. It's based on that other person making you feel appreciated, important, validated. They care about you. I think about, you know, my business coach and how he's walked through so many life things with me, where he's always focused on me. Every call is all about me, right? It's about my favorite topic, which is me. He's brilliant because he knows that's why I've been paying him for 7 years, like clockwork, month after month. And he doesn't do it in a manipulative way. He genuinely likes and cares about me as a human being, and we're friends. But he also knows that's the key to motivating me, unlocking the things that are holding me back, is how do I get into Nemo's head to, you know, get him motivated, get him excited, get him believing he can achieve this outcome he wants. He could be just pivoting to, you know, sell a service, sell a product, whatever, but he doesn't. And I think that's the key for you and me as we go through. This is such a good topic. This is such an important thing. And I love kind of one final thought that Carnegie says, because this is where it really gets good. This is really where you stand out from the competition with your product or service online. And Carnegie said this back in 1936. He said, "The person who has technical knowledge plus the ability to express ideas, to be a leader, to arouse enthusiasm among people, that person is headed for higher earning power." That's the thing. If you have the technical skills, the technical chops, you are really good at what you do, and you have that ability to, you know, human engineering, the ability to engage people, get them excited, motivated, appreciated, et cetera, tap into their passions, you're going to separate yourself dramatically from the competition. And that's why you want to really be bringing that into your marketing, into your social media, into your email marketing, into the copy you create, into your website, into your podcast, into your videos, sharing the real you, the authentic you, talking to the audience as if there's only one other person listening. I appreciate you. I understand you. I get it. It's hard. Tell me more about, you said you were going to do this or do that. And I just think that's such a critical element. And I think about the people that have had the biggest impact on my life, where, you know, when they've passed on and people have gone to their funerals, and the one thing everyone talks about is, man, they were all about relationships. They were all about people. Because the one currency that really lives on and keeps your memory alive is relationships. How did you treat others? What impact did you have? Did you make other people feel important and appreciated and validated? It's not just good business, it's good life. Like it's, you know, that's the big thing, is really understanding this is how to get ahead in business, yes, but it's also how to get ahead in life, so that when your day comes, you don't have that thought of, well, no one's going to come to my funeral. I just chew people up and spit them out and use them and don't care about them. And hopefully that's not your situation. Hopefully you're not that type of boss or that type of vendor or that type of person where people are just a commodity and everything else. And I get it. Look, I get it. We all have limited time. We can't be everyone's, you know, shoulder to cry on for 20 hours a day and be Oprah and Dr. Phil and fix everyone. But there's a fine line between that and then just being polite and being thoughtful and saying, hey, I know you mentioned you were going through a rough time because of this, thinking about you, hoping things are better. Just those little nuggets, those little sparks. Like, you know, here's what Carnegie says about that. And this is a good quote to finish on too. He says, you know, well, there's actually two. Now I'm reading all these quotes. I got to read them all. But he says, try leaving a friendly trail of little sparks of gratitude on your daily trips. When you're encountering people, sprinkle out little sparks of gratitude or appreciation for them. He says, you will be surprised how they set small flames of friendship that will be rose beacons on your next visit. These little sparks of gratitude and appreciation for people as you encounter them, the next time around, they remember that. They remember that you were kind, that you remember you were polite. They remember that you asked after their kids or their dog and how is your family doing. That really grows you in respect and reputation and memory of people. And the other big thing is we cannot forget this. As much as we want to think it's all about the product, the service, you know, our technical abilities, here's what Carnegie says. When you're dealing with people, let us remember we are not dealing with creatures of logic, right? We are dealing with creatures of emotion, creatures bristling with prejudices and motivated by pride and vanity. You are not dealing with creatures of logic. You're dealing with creatures of emotion. So if you don't engage your prospects, your customers, anyone else, your employees, your coworkers at a human level, you're really misfiring. You're missing that opportunity to advance to the goal, whatever it is, the sale, the product, getting better performance, all of those different items. So I could go on and on about this forever, but it was just such a striking story. It popped into my head the other day about, man, I still remember walking out of that funeral and that grouchy, crusty old boss going, no one's ever going to come to my funeral. And I should have said in that moment, well, yeah, they never will because of the way you treat them, but it's not too late. I should have said that. I didn't. I just didn't know what to say. You know, so I'm in Minnesota. We just stay passive. We don't confront directly, but you know, that's an opportunity and a life lesson that I never forgot. So hopefully you find that motivating and inspiring. Don't forget that 85% of your success today with work is going to be how you treat people and how you engineer that and how you are able to navigate through these creatures of emotion that you come across in your daily travails. So work on that. If you haven't already, get How to Win Friends and Influence People. It is such an important book. It is timeless. It's literally the book that I've built my business on for the last decade, and it's literally been indispensable because that is so much of the success is how to deal with people. So there you go. Get after it. Thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you soon on another episode.